Locked up and I'm so in my head. Heart starts racing and I can't slow it down. Hands shaking and I'm losing my breath. Paralyzed with the mind spinning out. My strength has grown weak. No words left to speak. I fall to my knees. Cause I know what I need. You are the light when my world goes dark. You hold me together when I'm torn apart. When my faults have run way too far. Hear the calm from my anxious heart. Up in the arms of your love, stilled by the silence above all the noise. Burdens light when you're lifting it up. Fears terrified by the sound of your voice. Cause you don't grow weak. Your word is peace. I fall to my knees. Cause I know what I need. You are the light when my world goes dark. You hold me together. When my faults have run way too far, hear the calm from my anxious heart. Hear the calm from my anxious heart. You know everything about me. You come and surround me, and everything that holds my soul. Falling to surrender, learning to remember. Control. You are the light when my world goes dark. You hold me together when I'm torn apart. When my thoughts have run way too far. You're the calm for my anxious heart. You are the light when my breath is gone. You are the hope when I'm stuck in the storm. I know this is still who you are. You're the calm for my anxious heart.
Thank you. everyone. It's a bit rainy outside today, but it's good to see all of you here. And hello to everyone that is at home. Let's take a few minutes and to greet all those of you that are here today. It's good to see you here.
Good morning. It's so nice to see all of you here. Thank you for coming out in the showers. Let's go ahead and bow our head for an opening prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we are all able to be here today, and we want you to pour out a special blessing on us and those that were unable to join us. Be with those who are online. Shower blessings upon them as well. We thank you for the showers this morning to kind of rinse everything off and give us a fresh start. Thank you, Lord, for all your many blessings. Thank you for being near us as we go through this Sabbath day. And thank you so much for giving us this Sabbath day of rest. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
For all of you that signed up for lunch at Heather's, don't forget to go there after church for a yummy meal.
Also, today after church, in the church office is our growth track, so lunch will be provided. So those of you who would like to attend that, please do.
Also, today at 4 o'clock, we will start the second session. Say 2 months ago, we started the first session of vertical marriage, and this time we're starting the next week's session that's called the Art of Marriage, and we'll be studying certain Greek words. The one we'll be studying today is called hesed. It's unwavering love. Unwavering love has characteristics that is outlined and shows the artist, the unseen artist of any type of picture. There are certain expectations you had in marriage, the purpose of marriage, we'll be discussing. But again, it all falls back to the hesek type of love that is unwavering in all conditions. See you at 4.
All right, I just want to bring your attention next Sabbath, which is April the 20th. There's an all-church potluck at Roger and Karen Anderson's home. So if you have any questions, you can talk with Karen or call our church office.
And children, it's now your time. If you want to come down and collect all those little dollars and come put them in our church and then come up here for a children's story where we have Christy telling you of a very exciting story.
Lord, if we could, we would fill our hands with all the wonderful things you give us. Then we'd lift them up and give them back to you.
Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath. I, in my heart, know that heaven sings extra loud on Sabbath morning when they see the children come to church. What do you think? I was thinking over in my head what story I wanted to tell you today, and I couldn't quite decide until a friend called me yesterday, and it reminded me of something we had done together, and I thought I would share that story with you today. How many of you have been afraid? You're afraid of something or you've been afraid some? Yeah, right? Everybody raises their hand. We all have times when we're afraid. Well, she reminded me of a time that we were afraid and we probably shouldn't have been afraid, but, you know, everybody gets afraid, even moms and dads and older people get afraid of different things. And so we worked at summer camp together, and I was in charge of the swimming pool. And I was also in charge of games after dinner. And she was in charge of trail riding with horses. Well, one day she came, rode her horse up to the outside of my pool, and she said, "Let's go on an adventure today. Find somebody to do your recreation after dinner, and let's go for a horse ride out to where the cowboys are sleeping tonight." So I thought, oh, good idea. Let's do that. Because, you know, that's what you do with friends. When they say, "Let's go on adventure," you do it, right? Well, down deep inside, I was saying, oh, my goodness, riding a horse. That's the one thing that I'm a little bit afraid of, is horses. But I thought, you know what, it's my friend, we're going to do it. So we got all ready, we put our backpacks and our sleeping bags on the back of our horse, and we went for a ride. And she said, we need to hurry because we need to get there before dark. So she starts running her horse, which is okay for her because she loves horses and she was really good at it. But I wasn't so good at it, and I'm kind of afraid of them. So can you guess what I was? I was afraid. Yeah? And instead of flowing with the horse like she did and looking so beautiful on the horse, I looked like a piece of popcorn popping in the microwave. And I was going up and down like this and side to side, and I thought, okay, I've just got to hold on because I'm going off this horse. Then she starts going faster, and I'm like, no, don't go faster. She goes, no, faster. We got to go faster. We got to get there before dark. So she kept riding faster and faster, and I just was holding on for all I was worth. And you know what? I made it all the way to cowboy camp without falling off. I was sideways quite a few times, and the horse was kind of wondering what kind of a rider I was. But we made it out to cowboy camp. And we had such a good time out there. We played with all the kids, and we played games, and we roasted hot dogs, and it was a lot of fun. And then she said, okay, well, let's get our sleeping bags out. And I was kind of looking around thinking, where are we going to sleep? I don't see any beds. Well, we're sleeping on the ground like the cowboys do. I was like, sleeping on the ground? Okay, so let's do it. So we roll out our sleeping bag, and all the girls slept over here, and they had a big fence around them, and the boys slept over there, and they had a big fence around them, and the horses were all in the back. And I was like, okay, well, are we going to go with the girls? No, we're not going with the girls. We're going to sleep by the fire. Well, that sounds kind of fun, I think. I enjoyed it. I laid down. I got my sleeping bag. I snuggled in, and even though I was afraid, I thought, this is going to be okay. We can do this. And my girlfriend, this was all just natural to her. She didn't know what was wrong with me. Why would I be afraid of riding horses out into the woods? Why would I be afraid of sleeping in a sleeping bag by the fire? So we drifted off to sleep. In the middle of the night, I kind of opened my eyes and I looked up, the most beautiful stars overhead. So beautiful. I highly recommend sleeping outside in a sleeping bag with your mom and dad near. And it was so pretty. And then all of a sudden I kind of felt something. And I kind of looked around, but I didn't really see anything because it was really dark. And then I thought I felt something on my sleeping bag, and I'm like, oh, okay, this is just a little bit too scary for me. So I just laid there and I just said a prayer, dear Jesus, please help me go back to sleep. Please help whatever's sitting on my sleeping bag or crawling on my sleeping bag to find another place to rest, because this is my sleeping bag. And I was able to go back to sleep. Well, the next morning, the wranglers, who are the guys in charge of getting all the horses ready, came over, and they're like, you guys, did you see that mountain lion? And I'm like, a what? They're like, a mountain lion. I said, how did you know it was a mountain lion? Well, look at the footprints on your sleeping bag. I was like, okay, well, those are pretty big kitty prints. I guess there was a mountain lion, and that's what I felt on my sleeping bag. But you know what? We made it through. And you know why? Because we have amazing guardian angels, and we have an amazing God who watches over us. He knows everything there is to know about us, and he protects us and takes care of us. And I was reading in my devotion this week about being afraid and how we don't have to be afraid. But when we are, we can give it to God and say, God, you can take care of my being afraid because I know you know me and I know you have plans for me and you're going to take care of me. And it says in Matthew 10 that he even knows about the little sparrows and he loves them, but he loves you way more. He even knows how many hairs you have on your head. Is that amazing? It gives me goosebumps to think that he knows us that well. So just remember, when you're afraid, it's okay to talk to God in a prayer or just talk to him out loud and say, I'm a little bit of afraid right now. There's a mountain lion sitting on my sleeping bag. And you know what? God can bring you peace and protection. Thank you for listening to our story. Have a happy Sabbath.
I'm testing out this new ramp here, and Rachel is just making sure I don't fall off the edge. That would make for entertaining church, wouldn't it? I have a feeling that Alejandra had something to do with that, and I don't know who else, but thank you to everybody that made me a little ramp. Who?
Jack.
Oh, thank you. Awesome. Look at that. Not just for me, anybody else who needs a ramp to get up here. Now we have a ramp. That's awesome. Thank you so much. Great story, Christy. Sometimes I feel like I have a mountain lion on my sleeping bag, and I will remember that story and your prayer. Now it's time for our offerings. It's time to give back to God for all that he does and all that watchful care that he gives to us, and to thank him and to acknowledge that he is the one who is our provider. So you can give online, you can put it in an envelope and drop it in the slot next to the welcome booth, or you can mail it in, any of those ways. But we want to be faithful to give back to our God. So, and we're going to have a time of prayer, but before I go into prayer, I have some readings. We have one person transferring into our church and two people transferring out. The person transferring in, I don't actually need to say her name to remember it, because it's Sarah Tank, my sister-in-law, transferring into Modesto Central from Ceres, and very excited to have Sarah transferring in. She's not here right now, but this is the first reading. We're so happy that she decided, no, I did not coerce her, I did not bribe her, neither did her brother, just so all is clear. She just chose on her own that she wanted to come join our family. So happy for that. First reading for Pasita Ainsworth is going to transfer back to Parkwood. Now, Parkwood was always her family church, and she's wanting to go back. They had transferred over at a time they weren't well, and she's just wanting to be back with who's always been her church family. So they will still come visit us. They've promised her and Phil that they will come and see us here too. And then Chris Brizendine, who is transferring to Walla Walla University Church, and of course, he's going to be too far away to commute. So, all right. So that's the first reading for all of those, and we wish everybody well as we, as church family, shift around to whatever churches God is calling us to. All right. We'll now go into a time of prayer. And if you want to kneel, stand, stay seated, bow your head, raise your hands, whatever position you feel, let us come together before our Lord. Dear Father in heaven, we are so richly blessed by your love that sometimes we forget about it. It's so prevalent, it's so all around us. It's in the sun that shines on us, it's the rain that feeds the fields that end up feeding us. It's in your constant grace, it's in your still small voice. It's in your open arms and your constant opportunity to come and worship, to come and hear a word from you, to read your word, to hear songs of you, to be reminded that you are alive and that you care about our lives and that you're in this world. Lord, your love is prevalent all around us. And Lord, I just want to pause for a moment for us to take a time just to ask your forgiveness for when we forget that, when we get too busy, when we get distracted. Thank you for your grace and your mercy and your forgiveness. Your word says that all have sinned and fall short, so you're not surprised that we're imperfect. We are your children. Your word also says to return to you and you will return to us, and it's just that simple to turn around, to turn our face towards you, and you're so happy to put your arms around us, and we want to thank you. Lord, there are so many cares and burdens in each person's life represented here, and you know each one. You said to cast our care on you because you care for us. So Lord, whatever it is that is burdening in our heart, Lord, may we just take it and fully give it to you. to remember that you are God of heaven and earth, that you are our beginning and our end, and that we are in your hands, so we can trust our cares safely with you. We can trust the people we pray for into your hands and know that you love them more than even we do. And we know and trust that your Spirit is contending for them in their lives and whatever they're battling. Lord, we know that you are the great physician, and we trust in your healing power moving among us, in those that need healing, in our family, our friends, ourselves. And Lord, we know that you're moving in this world. Your word tells us to pray for our leaders and to pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world. So we do pray that your Spirit would lead our leaders. It's a difficult time to look towards those leading us in politics, Lord. But we pray for your peace and to remember that you are ultimately the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And that even though there's uncertainty all around us, Lord, the one thing that is certain is that your will be done. Either things will fall apart faster and you will come sooner, or you will shore things up to extend the time for whatever reasons, but we know that all things are in your hands. And ultimately, you are our main authority, and we can trust in your love. So thank you for hearing all our prayers and handling all these things that are just too big for us, your children. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Now I get to go downhill. And Rachel's especially ready for this.
Oh, wow. That scared me a bit.
Sorry.
It's okay. I'm kind of used to that because these two boys behind me they're cyclists, so they race. They race, and sometimes they go descend like almost 40 miles per hour, and I don't know why I allow that, but I just watch my heart drop to my stomach every time. Well, thank you so much for the warm welcome. This is actually our second time being here at Modesto Central. And it's so nice to see many familiar faces because of Pit Stop and Worship Night. And these are my children. My name is Jean. This is Juliana, Josh, and Jacob. And it's really an honor and privilege to be here with you all to worship and praise our Lord God. The first song that we will be singing, maybe to many of you, you guys haven't heard of this song yet, but I'm sure you guys know this story. It's your story, it's my story, it's the story of God with us. It's called the King of Kings. So please let this be something that our hearts and mind throughout the day we'll meditate upon, on even actually every day. Sing with us if you know it. If not, may the words bless you. Next song is called "Here I Am to Worship." What are we here for? To worship. And worship is not just like this, singing and playing instrument or singing with us. Worship starts in here. You guys are not here. We are not here by accident. And those who tune in online, you're not tuning for it because it's just a coincidence. We don't believe in that. Because God has called you, and he's such a good, loving God, despite of what we go through, that we can only find comfort. He's a God of all comfort. That's one of my favorite character of God, that no matter what I go through, when I open the Bible and read all this testimony of other people that didn't receive the promise, it's not what our Sabbath school is about. They didn't receive the promise, yet they have a powerful testimony that God is good and God is love. Because we can only find that comfort in him. It's a mystery, but it's real. Let's sing "Here I Am to Worship."
Beauty that made me
that this is now our true home, please stand. Sing with us. This is why, even though they didn't receive the promise, all the saints that we have in the Bible, it's because they know that they are waiting for the true home. And that when they open their eyes, it's just like happened just a second, they will be in their home, and that is Jesus being with them face to face. Let's go. Let's go and sing, I Wanna Go to Heaven.
Amen. Thank you to our church family from Patterson coming here to lead us in worship today. That was a blessing. Thank you so much. Let's give them a hand just to say we love you and we're so glad you came. We can't all give you a hug, so this is a hug to say thank you for coming and sharing your gifts and talents with us. All right, we're in week two of our three-part sermon series called Paint Me a Picture. We're looking at different colors, and today is blue. And before I start speaking, I'm going to start with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we know that you're present here. We've already prayed. We've invited you in. I just want to pause a moment longer to just confess my need to once again ask you to completely remove me out of the way, remove all of our distractions, that in this moment that we might hear your Spirit speak to our hearts, whatever it is we need to hear, that you would speak through me whatever it is you need to say. Lord, this is your time. And as I often pray, may we all leave here knowing that we've been in the presence of our living God and that he's had something for us, that he's said something to us here today. And may those words sink deep into our life and draw us near to you and work the changing, healing power in us that you mean them to do. So thank you for hearing these prayers, Lord. Speak now. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, so last week we talked about the light of the world stepping down into darkness. I love that you sang that today. And as we're looking at colors, we're looking at light. I'll just do a quick review before we get into blue. So we looked at how the light of the world comes in, the white light, and that gives us these different range of colors that we see. And we talked about red last week and all the meanings of red in the Bible. And we touched on how red is actually the color that helps us see the best in the dark. So it's the best color for us coming out of darkness is that we start to see red and we recognize the blood of Christ, the sacrifice of Christ, and we start to see his love. And that really is what the foundation that opens us up to see all the other colors and insights and things that God would teach us. It all starts from there. So the next two colors we're covering are blue and purple. You can see at the other end of the spectrum. I'm very excited. I really love blue. So I love them all, but I'm excited about today. So I just want to look at a couple things though, that relate to blue and red. First, looking at this. This is the heart, the vein system in the body. You notice what colors it's made out of. Don't you find that interesting, that it's blue and red? Right? It will be even more interesting after we talk more about blue in the Bible, because red we know is the blood of Christ. Blue is also who God is. It relates to the character of God. And so when we talk about him giving us the blood of his life, he is also giving of us his character that he works in us. So I think this is amazing. And I think God created all things and he meant it to be this way. And then I want to talk just really briefly another thing about blue. As I said, we talked about red being the light that helps us see the best in the dark. Blue is the light that wakes us up. I have something called hypersomnolence. It's better, much better in California than it was when I lived in Seattle. When I was in Seattle, because it's so gray and the lack of sun complicates it, that when my alarm went off in the morning, I would have to turn a blue light on next to my bed to help me wake up. Because that's what blue light does, right? And you guys probably know all the studies that it's not good to be on your computer or your phone at nighttime because it's blue light. So it keeps you from sleeping, actually. So it's much better to turn red light on. And God is the creator of heaven and earth, right? So the beautiful thing here is that when the sun rises, it rises from more red colors and gradually goes into more blue colors. Midday is the most blue colors. And as we go back into night, it goes back down into the red colors because God is preparing us to go to sleep, right? And as silly humans, we go turn on all the blue light. And then we wonder why we don't sleep well. Well, there we have it, right? All right, so some of the things about that we see in the world that relate to color and our creator and our God. And we're going to jump in now to looking at blue in the Bible. And I'm going to start with a place where you may not think that you would find it. And that is in this story in Luke chapter 8, starting with chapter 40. And I'm going to paraphrase this because it's a long section. So this is a story where Jesus is walking back through town, and Jairus, a synagogue leader, runs up to him and says, "Please come to my house. My daughter is dying." And he wants Jesus to come help him. And then while he's on his way and there's a crowd there, a woman comes up who's been bleeding for 12 years. She doesn't want to be seen. She would be an outcast of society, just to explain. Because of this bleeding that she had going on for this long time, she would have been considered ceremonially unclean for 12 whole years. That means that she cannot go to church. She cannot fellowship with her believers. Can you imagine to be struggling with something and not be allowed to go to the place where you should be able to find God and help? Instead, she was kept from it. She wouldn't have been able to be around people who were going to church because being with her would make them unclean. So she would be ostracized. And she's had this problem, and whatever resources she had, she's spent on all kinds of doctors. And obviously she hears about Jesus and the things that he's been doing. And she's in this crowd, probably hiding, sneaking, because she doesn't want anyone to point her out that she's unclean, and then they may be upset that she's among them. But she says, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, if I could just touch the hem, I know that I will be made well. And she does. She gets down there, she touches the hem, and she can tell that she's made well. And she's going to let it go. She's not going to bother him, right? You know, you can tell how small she's made herself to disappear. And she would have disappeared into nothingness except for Jesus knew that somebody touched him. And the disciples are like, he stops, everyone's like, somebody touched me. And the disciples are like, are you crazy? You're in a crowd. Everybody's touching you. What are you talking about? You know, and Jairus is like, don't stop. I need you to come to my daughter, right? You can imagine. But Jesus is like, no, somebody who needed me, somebody who believed in me, somebody who needs to be recognized, who has been set aside and put in a corner and felt invisible for 12 years, needs to know that I see them. And so he gives her an opportunity to say that she touched him. And she does. She says, it was me. And he says this beautiful thing, and it makes me tear up, because imagine how outcast she has been, probably from family, from friends. And yet Jesus takes this moment and he says to her, daughter, daughter. He restores her fully to family, to being not just acknowledged, but intimately acknowledged and cared for and loved. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Can't imagine what this must have meant for her. But the story goes on, and he goes on to the official's house. And as he shows up, they're saying that the daughter had died. And he says, don't be afraid, only believe. Remember, he's just had this example. Jairus just had this example of this faith of this woman. And he says, just believe and she'll be made well. And then we see in verse 51 that now it's not just the father there, but the mother is there. And they go in, and even though people are weeping and the mourning has already started, Jesus says that she is not dead, she is only asleep. And he goes in and he says, child, arise, and she comes back to life. So that other picture there that Jesus reminds us that death is just a place of sleep before he wakes us up. So this is the story. This is this section. I want to point out a few things in this section in case you haven't noticed them before. And we can't say for sure, but there are certain things that you can get some idea of possibilities of what might be going on. One of them is, and you may not have noticed this, but the daughter is about 12 years old. The woman has been bleeding for 12 years. There are a lot of scholars who believe that this woman might actually be the mother of this child. It's possible that when she gave birth, this issue started. And that could be why we see just the father in the beginning, but at the end, the family is restored. The mother and the father are present now that she is made well, and then the daughter is healed. So, what a beautiful picture of how God cares for families and how he wants to bring healing. So, a little plug for the art of marriage and God's desire to heal our homes and bring unity there. So, this beautiful picture of God's care for us Also, the fact that he's going to resurrect a daughter and heal the daughter on the way, this imagery of us as his children and the daughter of his church overall, the woman of his church, that desperately needs this healing of faith, that needs the ability to touch him by faith, to have his faith and come into life. So just a couple of things for us to think about as we go into this, to looking now at where's blue. And you may be like, where's blue? And you may read through this and look through it, and you're not going to find the word blue there. I'll tell you what you're going to find. You're going to find this. She came up behind him and touched the fringe or hem of his cloak, and immediately her flow of blood stopped. And you may not know, but there is blue in that sentence. There's blue in the sentence because it would have looked a little bit like this when she reached out for it. There's a reason why she reached for his hem, why she reached for this fringe. There's meaning to that fringe and to the blue color that they were supposed to put in it. You see, going back to Numbers, it says this: tell the Israelites to make fringes on the corners of their garments throughout their generation, and to put a blue cord on the fringe at each corner, so that when you see it, you will remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them, and not follow the lust of your own heart and your own eyes. You see, God was trying to remind the Israelites that they had made a covenant with him, and to remind them to be faithful, he said, put blue on the fringe. And for me, I think that means like maybe mind your feet, right? Be careful, little feet, where you go, right? I don't know. But that's where he put it. And this blue was to remind them to be faithful. You see, blue symbolizes faithfulness to the covenant, that God has between him and his people. And he wanted this. So when she was reaching out to this corner, she was reaching out to this thing that she knew. It was a symbol of the commandments. It was a symbol of covenant and a symbol of faithfulness. Okay, so now we have two questions to answer. Why blue? It's the first one we're going to answer. And then why did the woman reach for this? Okay, first question, why blue? Sometimes I think I'm just preaching because I like the story so much. I don't know, but I'm excited about it. I get all excited. Why blue? All right, blue. So blue is central to God. He uses this color to represent himself. In Ezekiel 1:26, it says, describing the throne, the vision of his throne, and above the dome, over their heads, there was something like a throne in appearance like a sapphire, and seated above the likeness of the throne was something that seemed like a human form. You see this sapphire, this blue, it's foundational to the throne of God because he is faithful. So he has in his throne and his foundation faithfulness. And then what he asked all his people to do, and that was for all the Israelites to put blue in the robe, was for all of you to please be faithful. We are in a covenant, you see? And faithfulness is a part of who God is. So it's part of his throne. And then we see this. If you read in Deuteronomy, you're going to read about and Numbers and when you're reading about anything about the making of the temple, you're going to read about the ephod. And this is what the high priest would wear. And first of all, notice that the ephod, the foundation under it, is still blue. The high priest, number one, underneath that was blue. That's what carried everything, this symbol of faithfulness. And then this ephod is symbolic of the high priest carrying his people. You see those things on the shoulders, those two onyx stones, on each one was carved the names of Israel, the children of Israel. You see, he faithfully carried them. There's a verse in Isaiah that says, until you are old and gray, I will carry you. He is faithful to this promise. And then the rest of it is over his heart. And you probably can't make it out, but what all those different stones are, that is the weave of red, blue, and purple. Next week we're going to talk about purple. Last week we talked about red, talking about blue. And all those stones over his heart, each one represent one of the tribes of Israel. So this is God's people that he carries over his heart. So why blue? Because God is teaching us something. He's saying, I am faithful. I fulfill what I promise. I carry you on my shoulders. I carry you in my heart. My relationship and my covenant to you is important to me. That's the symbol of blue. In Matthew 22:37-40, it says, he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So you see, that covenant that he made, and that color blue, was always to be faithful to a covenant, a loving relationship with God. Because when we turn away, and back in Numbers it said, so that you won't turn away in the lust of your heart, that is actually spiritual adultery. It's unfaithfulness to a loving relationship. And in the Old Testament, adultery and idolatry are synonyms. Same word can be used in either place. This is what God longed for, like, remember me. Sort of like we would say, you know, someone wearing their wedding ring. Symbol of my loving covenant and my commitment. 1 John 4:8 says, whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. We usually think of red as the color of love. But I think we could also use blue. Because red is a color of sacrifice and blue is a color of faithfulness. And it takes both to truly love. And that's what God is. God is a God who will sacrifice for us, and he is a God who is unfailingly faithful to what he says he will do for us and to be there for us. God is love. Now, there's some people who want to say that the commandments are done away with. And I want to address a couple of those places, where they find that, where they say that. And people are at their own place with their conscience. I'm not trying to judge. But I want to teach actually what this is saying, what it does teach us. You see, Colossians 2:13-14, it says, God made you alive together with him when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. Okay? I want to say what this says and what it doesn't say. What it doesn't say is that he nailed the commandments to the cross. What it says is that he nailed the legal demands. And why do I think this is important? Well, let me scoot back. It does not say that he nailed the commandments to the cross. But I do want to say this. I think we could say that he did. I believe we can say he did. And here's the reason why. Because you cannot separate God from his commandments. Jesus was faithful to the commandments. Jesus is not a sinner. In order to not be a sinner, you must keep the commandments of God. In order for Jesus to win for us, to earn for us, to take on for us the ability to gain for us heaven, he had to do for us what we couldn't do, and what we could not do was keep the commandments. Therefore, Jesus had to do it, and they are his commandments about love, and they are an integral part of him. So if Jesus was on the cross, the commandments were on the cross. John says that he is the Word made flesh. If Jesus is on the cross, the Word of God is on the cross. You see, it's not just the sacrifice of God on the cross. It's his faithfulness on the cross. Because when he went up to the cross, he was keeping a promise that he would make a way for us. And he was revealing his love. But what this doesn't mean is it doesn't mean, oh, then we don't have to care about the commandments. Because to say we don't care about the commandments is to say we don't care about God himself. They are intimately, intricately together. I didn't say that word right, but you know what I mean. It's a mashup and you can't separate it. They're together, right? So when it says what he's setting aside is the legal demands, the thing that he's doing is he's saying, I've accomplished this for you. Therefore, everything that you have failed legally is gone away. That's what he's saying. That's what this is saying. Because we are incapable of keeping the commandments ourselves. So, this is going to get better. At least I think so. All right, so next one, Galatians 3, 24 and 27. I've heard people point to this and say, you know, when people want to tell me I don't have to go to church on Saturday, you know, sometimes it happens. Most Sunday, you know, people who go on Sunday don't try and correct me. But anyway, they will point to this sometimes. It says, therefore, the law was our disciplinarian until Christ came, so that we might be reckoned as righteous by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of as you were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. Okay, now some people want to say, well, you know, we didn't need the law. We don't need the law anymore because we have Christ. Here's what he's saying. We don't need the law written on stone because we have the law in Jesus, his righteousness, that if we are baptized with him and take him on in our life, we are enveloped by the law. Do you see what I'm saying? That's what that is actually saying, because he is the fulfillment of it. He has kept the promises that we could not. So we're not disciplined by the law, which means we don't have a law pointing at us saying, oops, you lied, now you're lost. Instead, we have Jesus over us and the law reminding us, you lied, that wasn't a good thing. And we confess our sins, and he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us. You see how that works? The law surrounds us, and the law leads us because we are in Christ. It is no longer the judge against us. Praise the Lord, right? Praise the Lord. It's not the disciplinarian in our life. Christ's Holy Spirit is the one teaching and guiding us now, not the law calling us out. Therefore, it is not this black and white thing. God is so good. Okay, moving on. Jesus said this, Matthew 5:17, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. See, he would not have said this, and then when he died on the cross, oh, sorry, I didn't mean it. You know, I'm just kidding. I really did come to do away with it, right? That's not what he did. He said, I've come to fulfill. And so when he was on the cross, being his faithful God coming to save us, he was fulfilling his covenant. He was fulfilling the law for us, his fulfilling righteousness for us, which is righteousness means right living in a covenantal relationship. So I want to look at that. So the law part, and he's coming to fulfill the law and the prophets. What does it mean by that? It means Jeremiah 31:33. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. This is the new covenant. This is what it talks about in Hebrews. And some of you are like, ah, I know, this is all review for me. But for those that it may not be, or for those that need a refresher, this is what Jesus came to fulfill. This is what the blue line means. This is what it means. When we can grasp this, remember, blue is the light that wakes us up. Blue is the strongest at the light of day. When we're fully walking in all the light of God, this is something that we come to understand. This is something that we want in our lives. We want him to work this in us. It's a beautiful thing for us. All right. A little reminder that it's his heart of love working in us to write his laws on our hearts, right? the blue, the faithfulness, to work in us to be faithful when we could not be faithful apart from him. All right, next question. Why did the woman reach for this? Why would she reach for that blue line? You would think in her time that she would, why would she reach for this? She may feel like I'm a sinner, right? Why would she reach for something that might remind her that she's failed of the commandments? You might ask yourself that question, but I don't believe she saw it that way. Why did she reach for this? Deuteronomy 27 and 28. Obviously, we won't read that all for you today either. Snapshot of Deuteronomy 27 and 28. It's the chapters that we call the curses and the blessings. You see, when God and his people made the covenant, and that covenant was based on mutual faithfulness to that covenant, on God's behalf that he would be faithful and care for his people, and on the people's behalf that they would maintain walking in his laws of love. If they failed that, they would get the curses. Then God's protection would be removed from them and they would face the consequences of life without their God with them. If they achieved that, they would get every blessing. Okay, so you may have heard me say this before, but if I was going to give you a synopsis of the Old Testament, I would say it's one long lesson to find out we can't keep the law and that we need a Savior. Okay? Because they would strive to keep this law, and God would send them prophets to say that you're failing of it, and then they would drift away as humans do because we are sinful human beings, and he'd send another prophet to say you better get back to it, and you better stop worshiping idols, and you get to get faithful to your relationship to me. And this went back and forth and back and forth all the way from Exodus until we get to the New Testament. So Israel, if in the time of Jesus, when he's walking there, if there's anything that a Hebrew should know, it is that we failed of keeping the law. Therefore, all the blessings of God are off the table. Except for this. When you realize your weakness, where it leads us to. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That gives me goosebumps. This is like, because he knew that you could not get an A on the test, he came and took the test for you so that you could get an A. Like, that's what it's saying. Like, this is so amazing. So that when we receive him and we see who he is in a spiritual sense, that we can get from him something that we could never get, that the law, the requirement of the law could be fulfilled. And to a Hebrew's mind, if that law could be fulfilled, all the blessings come with it. Do you see what I'm saying? So here we go. Here's this woman in Jeremiah, and I'm sure she knew this promise. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called, the Lord our righteousness. Do you see why this woman is reaching for that corner? Because if she sees Jesus as the Savior, as the branch of David, and she sees what he's doing, and she comes to believe, I don't have righteousness in myself, but if I can just accept him as the Lord, my righteousness, then everything comes with that. I'm excited. So she reaches out her hand. You know, so often we reach out our hand to Jesus and you paid the price for me. That is the red. But to reach out our hand and remember, you are my righteousness. To desire righteousness ourselves. Not just to desire forgiveness, but to actually desire righteousness and to know I can hold on to it in Jesus and to know that Jesus will work it in me at the same time, that is salvation. That is salvation. That's what she reached out for. The other thing is this, as we come to a close, that word for hem or corner or tassel in Hebrew, it also means pinion. It means pinion, which means wing. And we find it in this verse here, the same word, pinion. Psalms 91:4, he will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. He will cover you with his righteousness. And you will find refuge for every way that you've ever failed. And in him, you inherit everything that you could never have had apart from him. This is blue. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you that you use your word to help us to see you in so many different ways so we can learn more, so we can walk in the fullness of your light. That Lord, when we look on you on the cross, we're not just looking at sacrifice. We're looking at righteousness, at faithfulness, at you keeping your promise that you would come and be the Lord our righteousness for us. Lord, we thank you. Lord, I want to pray for anyone here or watching online that is maybe just realizing more about you. And Lord, if they're making a choice for you, I want to pray that you help them in their next steps in their walk. That may be to join us at Growth Track. That may be to go to the marriage thing today. It may be to fill out a connect card. It may be that the verse I read about baptism has touched their heart and they want to fully give their life to you, to accept you as their Savior and to accept your righteousness fully as their covering and to seek to live in a right covenant with you, to let you put that blue in us. Write that law in us, Lord, that we would live faithfully in you. So Lord, those of us who know this story, we renew our hearts, and those of us that may be new to, bless them as they grab onto the new pieces and continue growing in you. We love you, Lord. We thank you so much for painting us a picture today. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for coming this week. Next week, we will go over purple. If you happen to be here and maybe be interested in giving your life to the Lord, I am planning a baptism for the week before Memorial Weekend, and I forget the date. But if you're interested, please let me know. I would love to help you with that step. So God bless, have a wonderful week, and we will see you next Sabbath.